Hey everyone, it's Ty. This is Super Metal World. I'm here with John McEntee. John is the vocalist and guitarist of Incantation. Incantation recently released their newest album, Sect of Vile Divinities, love that name, via Relapse Records on August 21st. John, how's it going, man?
Oh, it's going totally awesome. Really happy. The vibe of the new album's been great. Just, you know, if the world wasn't going to shit, it'd be perfect.
Right, exactly. You know, it's one of those things where with every interview I've been doing this year, it's like that white elephant in the room that we just have to like get past. So let's just get through it. Did this pandemic have any effect on this album at all? The recording, the writing, what have you?
No, luckily we finished it beforehand. We finished it in early January 2020. Mm-hmm. So the only issue we really had was the video stuff. Didn't know what we were going to do. We were looking at all options, and man, all the options sucked, you know? Sure. So we were happy once, June came and some of the restrictions started lowering, we were able to get together and kind of quickly film some of the songs for, Fury's Manifesto song and Entrails of Hag Queen. We had to get some of the playing parts done in that little kind of a window as soon as possible because the deadlines were coming up. We were able to kind of fit it in. So that's the only problem. As far as everything else, it's, you know, everything else was finished. It just, I mean, it's kind of crazy, but the quarantine in a way kind of gave us enough time to really work on all the stuff we needed to do for the album because it's nice. It was nice to not like be forced to focus on the stuff we had to do instead of trying to juggle other stuff around at the same time. So for us, it worked out as positive. It's kind of like, it's a shitty situation, but we're the kind of band, we try to make the best of everything, you know? If you can't tour, you can still write music or you can still work on other stuff, you know?
Yeah, I was just going to ask, like, I'm sure you guys are kind of, it's forcing everybody to get a little more creative about how they promote it and maybe changing up even like merchandise or I don't know. Was there any thought into that? Like, hey, we got to promote this differently. Let's change up merch packages or something like that. I don't know.
It was a little bit of concern because obviously we weren't, some of our shows ended up getting postponed until next year. So that was a problem. So we kind of knew that we had to make a little more of a internet presence, but at first we were a little bit skeptical about it, but after doing like some, webcast kind of things, we started doing, we started focusing more on our web store to try to get, you know, new updated merchandise and just stuff like that. Things started working out a little better. I mean, you know, our web store sales definitely went up, from this, which was nice that people were, you know, supporting bands in this situation because, you know, we don't make a lot off merch. I mean, we don't make a lot off album sales and we can't tour. So it's like, fuck. Taking everything away, you know? So, but no, it's been good. And it actually gave me time to do a little bit of reminiscence too on, you know, our musical career, because as a band member, you don't get a lot of time to always look behind you. You're looking forward to your next thing. And you know, and not until you stop doing it, you know, that you look back and you realize, oh fuck, I did some amazing stuff. And so we had time to like go through some old flyers and just old memorabilia stuff from all the tours. And it was kind of nice to just be like, wow, we actually really did do a lot. Like I keep thinking in my brain, like, you know, we got to really hustle and kick some ass. And I'm like, man, we did a lot already. Like really super cool stuff. So it's all good. And and then we normally write after we do an album. It's kind of like when we finish the recording process part of the album, I know for myself, I get really inspired to write. It's just a, you know, it's a thing when you finish doing an album, you just feel like, you know, okay, this is done. Now I can be creative again from square one, you know? So we took
the
that time.
Clean almost.
Yeah. And we ended up, we were able to write a crap load of even brand new songs. And we had the extra time to really take them to a pretty advanced level. So we're actually, pretty well in the progress of getting even the next album done, which is nice.
That's awesome.
It's nice just that we're inspired enough to do it, you know, because after you do so many albums, I think a lot of bands sometimes lose inspiration, but there's like a synergy in the band that we just really are extremely inspired and we're just going with it, you know? It's like, there's no law saying that once you put out an album, you can't just write your whole next one immediately, right? You know? It's like, you can do whatever, you know? We don't like to go by like the normal rules or whatever, you know?
Yeah, that's interesting you bring that up, because metal is such a genre where there is like that almost unsaid standard where it's like, you know, you release an album and it's going to be at least like 2 years before we get your next one. Maybe it's four, maybe it's five, you know. If you look at pop music or hip hop or whatever, they're releasing stuff all the time. They're releasing like singles and they're, I know it's a different genre, different way of consuming music, maybe not as much focus on a full album experience, but I think it's okay to steal a little bit of those ideas of releasing music more frequently.
I understand what you're saying, but if you really look at it, I mean, you know, I come from an older generation, and from I was a child in the 70s, and you know, my teenage years was in the 80s, and bands back then were putting out albums sometimes twice a year. There was albums you put out, like, if you, like in the 70s when I was really, really young, I was into like Kiss and stuff, you know, and they put out some of their albums would be like 8 months apart or something for a short time span. But still though, it was just like, it would put an album tour. And you know, if you look at the early Black Sabbath albums, like their first four albums were done in like 3 years. So it was like less than an album a year.
That's very true.
You know, it's kind of, I understand, like now a band puts out an album, metal band, and it's at least 2 years, if not three, until our next album goes. And to me, it's not that it's a good or a bad thing, but it just, you know, if the inspiration comes sooner, you know, just get the album out sooner. There's no law saying that has to be done, you know, this way or that way. I know there's standards because they want, you know, the record label wants you to tour for and you want to recoup money. There's all business crap, but when it comes, you know, for us, it's like, we'll record the stuff and just give it to Relapse when we're ready and say, whenever you're ready, just release it, because, you know, we're done with this. Cause it's, you know, when you, as a songwriter, you want to be able to get that concept and get everything in context and just, you know, do it at the time that you're inspired to do it. You, you know, I don't want to do a tour for, you know, 2 years, like Profane Nexus, we toured for almost 3 years with only very little breaks. But I don't want to be forced, like, after that, to be like, okay, now we got to write now, you know, after we get back. It's like, no, you write whenever you feel like it, you know?
Right. You, like, strike when the iron's hot. And that's actually a really good point that I haven't considered a lot, is that it wasn't always this way. Like you said, like, you know, Black Sabbath didn't play by this rule of, like, two to 3 years, you know? So that, I think that's a very good point, because there's a lot of people of my generation, like millennial generation, that are just used to the whole... I'm talking millennials that are metalheads that are used to that 2 to 3 year thing. But then even like, if you go back to the 60s, I mean, didn't the Beatles release like a ton of albums? Like, I mean, they didn't wait either, really, did they? I mean, so
there's something like 70, I don't know. I mean, 64 to like 69, they released how many albums? I don't even know how many.
A ton.
Too many.
A ton.
And look at Iron Maiden. I mean, from 80 till about 86, they release an album a year, and those are monstrous albums, you know. I mean they're doing huge tours on top of it, you know. I mean, have this 2-3 year thing, that's only like, I thought it was weird when we released our first album, it was like 2 years since the second album came out, and I thought like at that time, like, holy crap, we're taking forever to do an album, you know.
right
and now it's like 2 years is like quick now, you know, it's just got, for some reason, it got longer and longer over time.
Yeah.
When, you know, it should, to me, it should just be, you know, just do it. I mean, cause there could be a time period of 3 years where a band feels super inspired. Let's get all those ideas out there while they're inspiration. Cause then you could get to another point in your life where you don't feel like writing music, and you're that's forced true. To, and that's when you put out some really lame stuff, you know, if you're not inspired.
Yeah, when it's almost like you're trying to write with writer's block, or you just don't have that inspiration. And
yeah, I mean, that's what
that makes a lot of sense.
We've always wrote music on our own terms. Mm-hmm. You know, just when we feel inspired to do it, we just do it. You know, it's you can't force that stuff to happen. You know.
Mm-hmm. My question about Sect of Vile Divinities. What was your particular goal with this album? Do you guys set out with like, hey, our goal is to, I don't know, we're going to do something different, or we're just going to be tried and true incantation? What's your thought process there?
If anything, it was just to kill every poser out there.
that's a great goal. I like that.
yeah, but I mean, really, everybody comes into the album with their own agenda to some extent, mm-hmm. and we just kind of collaborated all together. I mean, for me, I just look at it like I just want to express myself musically, mm-hmm. and put it out there, and however I feel is right, and just see what happens, you know. But
sure,
I think, I mean, if there was like a musical agenda, my biggest agenda that I had on this album was I wanted to concentrate a little more on some of the mid-tempo, the darker sounding mid-tempos, mm-hmm. because it was stuff that we did on some of our early material, like Onward to Golgotha and Mortal Throne of Nazarene, and also even like the Blasphemy album had some really good eerie mid-tempo parts. And I just felt we needed a little more of that flavor on the new album. So a couple of songs I wrote had that kind of flavor too, but also mm-hmm. I really wanted to get that double guitar part going, not necessarily double harmony, but like two guitar parts going at once, where we did a lot of that on like Diabolical Conquest, and mm-hmm. we did a little bit of it on like Mortal Throne, and you know, we've done a little bit throughout the career, but mm-hmm. I wanted to kind of emphasize more on that. I just thought it'd be, for me, it's just a fun goal. Like I just set these little goals for myself that I want to do, you know, a song that kind of has this kind of vibe to it. I think about the vibe I want to get, and I want to try to accomplish it. And I want to accomplish it in a way that fits in the context of the album. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, I guess at this point in my career, I make each album into a little game for myself. Like I want to do these things, conquer these things, and you know, I work really hard to try to meet up to the challenges that I give to myself, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I can't remember the name of the song, so I apologize, but there's that one song where it has that creepy lead where it's like hammer on pull offs. It's like, like that is an earworm, man. Just going to throw that out there.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, we're just trying to get the best vibe possible, you know? Mm-hmm. After writing music for so many years, you become like musically inclined in your head, mm-hmm. to just like, you get the feeling in your brain, and you want to put it to music. You want to get like these vibes out and try to express them. And
yeah,
it's not about like, is it how technical a part is or how simple a part is. It's just mm-hmm. the feeling you get when you hear the part. That's what's important. Right. You know, it's an important thing that I've learned since I started doing incantation. It's been like my main goal. It's like, if the riff is like super complex or super simple, it doesn't matter. It's like, mm-hmm. what do you feel when you hear that riff, you know? Because the riffs are feelings, each riff. It's not just notes. They're not just, it's not just, you know, music is the feeling you get from it, you know? And mm-hmm. a lot of the bands that I was inspired by, I liked them because they had a feeling to it. It wasn't always that they're technically proficient so well.
Yeah.
It was just that even if they were just clonking, you know, just doing open E chords the whole time, mm-hmm. the way they would hit it, the attack on it was what was important to me. The feeling I got when I heard it, kind mm-hmm. of thing, you know?
Yeah, I always think the most like basic or easy to understand example of that is AC/DC to me, because, you know, AC/DC, they write these killer riffs that are, they're very simple. I mean, as a beginner guitarist, you could learn a lot of them, but they play it with feeling, they play it with groove, and you just, you know, you lock into that emotion that they're channeling with that. So I totally get where you're coming from.
Yeah. I mean, for me, listening to AC/DC's Froze About the Rock mm-hmm. album,
yeah,
is such an amazing feeling on that album. I mean, mm-hmm. it's heavy, but it has like, you know, a cool kind of groove to it. It's mm-hmm. pretty simple songs, but man, they really made an atmosphere on that album. When I hear that mm-hmm. album, I just feel so proud to be a metalhead, you know?
Right. And it's funny because, you know, that was kind of back in like proto metal days where yeah. But nowadays people are like, kind of, they're like, oh, AC/DC's rock and roll. They're not metal. I feel like it's kind of unfair to just put them in that box, but I get it. Well, as metal's become more defined over the years.
Yeah. Well, the time that AC/DC came out, they were definitely considered more metal in general. I mean, mm-hmm. because at that time, most stuff that's considered hard rock now was considered metal. Right. You know, bands right. like Deep Purple were considered metal, and mm-hmm. Rainbow, and obviously Black Sabbath was. There was a lot of those bands from that era were considered metal or like mm-hmm. metal-ish, you know, or whatnot. It wasn't until the 80s where metal kind of really, I think, kind of formed into mm-hmm. its own kind of, okay, you know, like bands like Judas Priest and Iron Maiden kind of defined that mm-hmm. metal thing more, I think, you know, at least in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree with you. And then, you know, then you
even
have
Motorhead is like,
definitely.
It's yeah. almost, it's almost rock and roll. It's almost punk. It's almost metal, but there was no rules. It was just like,
yeah.
you know, they would just go out there and play like assholes and be like, this is, you know, right. for them, they look at it as rock and roll. Most people would probably look at it as metal or mm-hmm. like, you know, crossover metal punk or whatever. But, mm-hmm. you know, I don't know what, I mean, now I don't know what I call it. I just call it metal because for me, mm-hmm. when I got into that kind of stuff, I just called it metal and I still call it metal, you know?
Right. Right. I mean, you were growing up as all that was happening and yeah. what an exciting time. I mean, you could also probably, you give props to like all those thrash bands in the '80s too, that created that genre. And then,
well, it's an amazing time to see the formation of, I mean, heavy metal was already kind of starting to get together when I really got into the music scene, but mm-hmm. to see the formation of thrash really come together and see the formation of like the kind of crossovers and the early death metal thrash kind of stuff. It was just yeah. a really great time because the amount of subgenres weren't really so defined.
Right.
And
right.
to me, it actually is a better thing because the more you try to define something, sometimes the more you screw things up a little bit because mm-hmm. like, yeah, a band that I like to put in consideration, and you know, when talking about this is like a band like Sacrifice mm-hmm. from Canada. They had their first album was kind of, I considered it kind of death metal-ish. It was a thrashy death metal, but it was mm-hmm. death metal to me in the vein of like Possessed or something like that, where it was like, yeah, it had thrash elements, but it was also death metal. And, you know, but they formed more, you know, they progressed more into like an aggressive thrash band or something like that. But there was a time that, you know, time period where, you know, if you're looking for the heaviest, sickest thing, Torment mm-hmm. and Fire was one of those albums that was like, you know, it'd be Possessed, Venom, Torment and Fire, Celtic mm-hmm. Frost or something like that.
Yeah, right.
It fit in there perfectly. And I don't think it really mattered to them that mm-hmm. if it was defined as death or black metal, they were just playing what they played and they naturally went to, you know, more of a aggressive thrash way. But mm-hmm. I just look back at it. There was no real, you know, say it was less artificial boundaries, you know?
Right. Right. And I think that's a nice segue because, you know, you've been, I mean, has it been, I think I read it through an email that it's been about 30 years that you've been involved in death metal.
Well, in Incantation, I've been
okay. I was going to ask playing, like, right, right. Before that even.
Yeah. Before that I played in a band called Revenant for 3 years.
Yeah.
And before that I was just a raging metal maniac for a while. So it's really, it's a long freaking time. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't really consider when I was a child getting Kiss albums or like, it was like kind of like Kiss, AC/DC and Queen. I don't really consider those times as really me being a metalhead. Like it was kind of metal, but I just enjoyed it. But it wasn't until the 80s came and, mm-hmm. I started getting into the Judas Priest, and then you started hearing, Iron Maiden and bands like Venom and Exciter, mm-hmm. and, all this stuff, and that's like when it really possessed me to, mm-hmm. Get really, dig deep into it. And, it was just a progression. I mean, but also I was also into the more commercial metal too, to be fair. Like, mm-hmm. Bands like early Motley Crue and Rat, they were all really promising bands too at the time.
Yeah, yeah.
But, it was just, for me, my journey was just naturally to kind of go heavier. And I also dabbled in a lot of hardcore stuff too, like mm-hmm. Dead Kennedys was really extreme for that time. And,
right.
MDC and Black Flag, and because mm-hmm. it was just about trying to be as pissed off and tell the world to fuck off, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. just the piss and vinegar, so it mm-hmm. all worked together well as a great unit. And somehow that all just, once I started getting more into like the actual demo and tape trading days of the music scene, which probably around 86, 87, 88, mm-hmm. was really 89 even, I was really into the tape trading thing. And that's when I really started to like zone in. Okay, this is where I need to go with Incantation as a band. Like, this is my future, is channeling this more aggressive, darker areas of mm-hmm. Metal. And, there was a lot of prototype death metal bands out there at the time. And there some albums were starting to come out around that time, like Altars of Madness by Morbid Angel and the Terrorizer and some grindcore like Napalm Death. And I just had more of a connection to that kind of stuff than, the thrashier stuff at that time. I didn't like, because it was getting more refined, and there a lot mm-hmm. of them were going in a more anthraxy style of mm-hmm. Thrash. And I really liked the more, like a Slayer or something like that, or like old Exodus. I didn't mm-hmm. like that nicer style of thrash. So it was just, just getting more into it. And the more darker stuff I heard, I was like, wow, I really relate to this stuff a lot. And then I just started realizing that I could write that kind of stuff well. And that was where I found, I guess, all that piss and vinegar I had as a teenager really started to come out. And it just seemed like a natural form of expression. But yeah, it's crazy. It's been so long and such a... it's an amazing journey to see the music from its infancy, even though I didn't start Incantation in its infancy, of death metal. I started a little bit after it, but just to see the death metal come from early stages to where it is today is just amazing, because I never would have thought death metal would have lasted long. I mean, even by the time we put out our album, I thought, maybe, it's a 5-year longevity and mm-hmm. something else will come around. I never think about, 30 years later, we're still playing it. And the thing that I'm really honored about is that, in our own way, we corner niched our own market for death metal. Like, there's bands now that sound like us, mm-hmm. that are influenced by us from back in the day, which is something we never even really thought about before. So it's really phenomenal. I'm pretty damn happy with the way things went. I definitely wasn't expecting, anyone to give a crap this late in my career as far
as
music, be honest about it,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially how much, like, metal has continued to progress into extremity, which we've talked, not you and I, but, the metal community, metal journalism, we've talked about that for a long time, how, it's continued to kind of actually progress away from, like, the mainstream. And still new and exciting things are happening in death metal. And that kind of brings the question, like, when you see all these new death metalers, like the new death metal bands popping up, does that inspire you? Are there any particular ones that you're, like, really impressed by, or do you not even, like, so much pay attention to that?
I mean, I don't pay attention as much as I did when I was younger, mm-hmm. when it was fresher. But the problem is just that since I've been there from essentially close to the beginning, at least, when I hear bands play the old school style, obviously I'm happy that I'm mm-hmm. hearing that old school and that more mm-hmm. primitive way of doing things, sometimes it's not so impressive because I did hear the originators do it and stuff like that. And it's not quite as fun. Or if a band does sound a lot like us or something, it's not so enjoyable to listen to for myself. It's not that I have anything against it, but I don't even listen to my own band because, you know, I feel like I have no need to, you know?
Right.
But at the same time, I think it's really good because there are some bands that are using, you know, the tools from the past, but using their own imagination to come up with great new ideas and push music to different areas and limits and stuff. And that's really important because death metal especially shouldn't, I don't think it should be so segregated as a style. Bands should be able to do whatever they want. And the thing that makes death metal or any kind of music great is the variety in it, the variety of other people's personalities and takes on it. So I'm 100% for bands that, you know, they might listen to some of the old bands and be inspired, but then they take it and they do it in their own way. And it's nice because they're not just doing it in a modern way. Some of them are doing it in a very old school way, but they're doing it now, but they're capturing that old school sound, but they're also doing stuff that, you know, would have been interesting to hear. You could have heard 30 years ago and would have really made probably an impact even more if they would have done it back then, you know? And I know it's difficult for bands now, younger bands, to say be original or whatever, because people can say everything is done, but I don't know. I mean, maybe it's true, maybe it isn't, but for me as a songwriter, I feel like there's always something new to accomplish or to conquer songwriting wise. I mean, yeah, a lot of our stuff has, I mean, it all sounds like Incantation, but I still think, you know, there's enough new ideas to throw in there, enough new ways of doing things. I mean, that's part of challenging yourself as a songwriter. You know, the challenge is to come up with something cool. It's not about copying what we've done in the past verbatim. Right. I mean, there's no reason to. I mean, I love those old songs, but I don't need a new version of any of our great songs. I want to have new versions of new songs that are creative in their own way, you know, and still keep the tradition of the old school sound. But it's going to happen because, you know, anything we do sounds like us. It's just because when we record, we record without trying to manipulate our sound so much that it loses the feeling of it. You know, a lot of bands also these days use a lot of studio trickery, and they really quantize the drums out a lot and grid everything up. And to me, that's really the death of good music, because having those real drums, the real timings, the fluctuations, those are things that make music great. I mean, all the music I grew up with as a child and as a teenager, none of it had quantization or any grid stuff. It was just play the damn song, and if it's good, if it's at a time here, not every time you go into the verse, it's not exactly the same beats per minute, you know, who gives a crap as long as the song sounds good, you know? I mean, so I think now when you hear bands that do that, that's usually when their personality really gets stripped out. And that's unfortunately, a lot of the more technical bands do that, or a lot of like the really faster death metal bands rely a little bit too much on technology. And they should, in my opinion, they should go more with the raw energy, which give them a lot more personality. And probably they would do better because it would sound like them, you know. It wouldn't just sound like, you know, it's easy to sound like any other band that uses technology like that. It's easy to sound like that, but it's not easy to sound like yourself unless
that's very true.
Let it happen.
Yeah. I was gonna say that's true not only as being in a band, but just being a person in general, being a human.
I mean, the good thing about being me is I could be the best me possible. No one could ever be me. They could try to play music similar to me, but they'll never be me.
Right, exactly.
Probably lucky for them, but it's cool.
Well, John, I think that's a great way to wrap it up here. So I just I wanted to thank you so much for taking, you know, the 30 minutes to chat with me. Everybody, make sure you check out Incantation's newest released Sect of Vile Divinities. It's available everywhere right now as we speak. We'll have links down in our description here. You can go check it out and go purchase the album, purchase the merchandise. I mean, so many musicians on top of this. I mean, for one, it's a badass album, but two, this pandemic's been hard on everybody, especially metal musicians. So go check that out and make sure you subscribe to us too on YouTube. Subscribe, click the bell. You'll be notified of our new episodes. We're available on all social media at Super Metal World. We have a website, www.supermetalworld.com. John Horns High, man, it's been a pleasure. Thanks so much for chatting with me.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the chat. And I just want to say, just check out our new album and listen to it in full. Don't be a poser and just listen to like 10 seconds and pass it up. Do it like the old school way when you used to have to go to the record store, pay 10 bucks for the album, listen to the whole thing. If you thought it sucked, listen to it again until you liked it. I used to do that. Some of my favorite albums of all time are ones that I didn't like when I first heard it or didn't get it when I first heard it. So, you know, give it its true due. And if you do hate it, have a blast. Hate it. I don't care. Definitely.
Thanks, John.
Thank you.